Hi everyone! Welcome back to another Planetarium stream. My name is Jessica. I am the director of the Planetarium, and happy summer solstice! It's been a kind of gray summer solstice for our longest day of the year here in the Northern Hemisphere, but we are officially into summer, which I guess some people like. I prefer winter, but I'm crazy. With me, I have one of my students who I will let introduce himself.
My name is Eli. I'm a physics and astronomy student at UMD.
So tonight we are going to be looking at the Northern Lights, look at kind of what causes them, and then we'll give you some tips and resources to help you see them for yourself if you so desire. If you have any questions throughout, you can put them down in the comments. Eli will be checking those periodically and will let me know of any questions that come up. And of course, if we don't get to them right away, we will take time at the end to answer your questions. So with that, I am going to get us switched over. Don't know why that's doing that, but okay. Why is it cropped like that? Sorry, folks, give me 1 second. This is what you gotta do sometimes. There we go. Okay, now it's not cropped all weird for you. So, as I said, we are gonna be talking all about the Northern Lights, or the Aurora. And why are you not? There we go. Okay. So, the Aurora are generally described as this, like, dancing curtain of lights that you can see in the nighttime sky. You can have a variety of colors from greens, reds, purples, blues, and we're going to explain kind of why all of that happens, where all the colors come from, all of that fun stuff. But the first thing to note is that the Aurora, why is this not changing? Come on. All right. We are apparently going to have technical difficulties today. So let's try this again. All right. We'll just go with this. So the aurora actually occur around both of Earth's poles, around the North Pole and the South Pole. The aurora kind of occur in this circle or oval around the poles, which we call the auroral zones. Auroral is a very difficult word to say. If you don't believe me, try it yourself. And so the actual size of these zones kind of varies, and we'll explain why. But it's within these zones that you could see the aurora in the sky. So you have to be within this auroral zone. The aurora itself also occurs kind of higher up in the atmosphere. It doesn't come all the way down to the ground. Now, for the aurora around the two different poles, they have different names. And so the aurora borealis is the aurora that occurs around the North Pole. And the aurora australis is the aurora that occurs around the South Pole. Now, the name aurora actually comes from Greek mythology. Aurora is the named for the Roman goddess of the dawn. She kind of traveled from east to west, announcing the coming of the sun. So the aurora, you kind of think of as like the bringing of the light. And then borealis comes from the word boreas, which means wind. And so the aurora borealis is this northern wind that brings the light. And then the aurora australis is the southern wind that brings the light. Now, the Greeks aren't the only cultures that saw the aurora and had sort of mythologies and explanations behind it. One of my favorite actually comes to us from Finland, and they have this whole really cute story about how the aurora is created by kind of the tale of the Firefox. And so I want to show you a short part of an animated clip that kind of explains this. And sound is not working, but we'll just go with it. So the general idea is that there is this fox that was created that has this long, flowing, kind of fiery tail. And so what they saw as the aurora is this fire fox's tail kind of flowing through the sky as the fire fox flies around. Now, I do have the link to this full animated short in the description for the video. I highly recommend going and watching it because it's adorable. But that's, yeah, one of my favorite mythologies behind the aurora. Now, the Chinese also saw aurora. And to them, the aurora symbolized this kind of great celestial battle between good and evil dragons. And so the aurora was the dragons themselves battling it out. And then to the Inuits, they saw the aurora as the spirits of dead humans playing a ball game with a walrus skull. And so the kind of dancing lights are the spirits of their ancestors kind of dancing around, running around, playing this ball game. All right, so the aurora have lots of fun stories. We've been able to see them for many centuries, but it hasn't been until, you know, relatively recently that humans understood exactly what was causing them. And so the cause of our auroras start with the sun. So the sun is a star, just like the stars we see up at night. It's a big ball of hot gas. And what happens is the sun is constantly kind of blowing out the stream of charged particles that we call the solar wind. And so these charged particles, like you can see here, are constantly kind of blowing off the sun, out and away from the sun, out in all directions. And so there's constantly the stream of charged particles coming from the sun towards the Earth. Now, in addition to that, every so often, the sun will give off a flare. And what's happening with the flare is you have this loop of gas that's kind of arching out over the surface of the sun. And as that loop stretches, sometimes it stretches so far that it actually snaps, just like when you stretch a rubber band too far. And when it snaps, it flings that gas out into space. And that's what a solar flare is. And so we have this steady stream of solar winds, and then every so often we have an additional kind of boost or an additional kind of flinging of extra particles away from the sun due to these flares. Now you can also have even more massive events called coronal mass ejections, but they're the same thing. It's just like a really, really big flare. And so what all of this means is we constantly have stuff from the sun being flung at the Earth. And that can sound scary, I know that, but for the most part, it doesn't really affect us because the Earth is like a big magnet. We can think of it as having this giant bar magnet inside the Earth. It's not exactly a bar magnet, but it works similarly, so we can kind of just think of it that way. And what the magnet does is it surrounds the Earth in a magnetic field. And we represent that magnetic field with these kind of like curved lines that you're seeing. And if you've ever played around with a magnet and some iron filings, you see that the iron filings follow that curved path around the bar magnet. That's what we're seeing. That's that curved lines of the magnetic field surrounding the bar magnet. And so the Earth has the same thing. And so what this magnetic field does is it acts like a shield around the Earth. And so it deflects and blocks most of the stuff coming from the sun from hitting the Earth. It just gets directed around our magnetic field and doesn't hit us, which is great and wonderful. And that keeps us from having problems like having our atmosphere stripped away by the solar wind, which would definitely be a bad thing. But what we can see here is while most of the stuff is deflected away, some of it, tiny little bit, gets through. And when it gets through that magnetic field, that kind of shield, it gets trapped in those magnetic field lines, which then cause those particles to be funneled down to either the north or the south pole. And so that's what starts to create these auroras and why they're kind of centered around the two poles, because it's our magnetic field, which comes out of the poles, that's trapping those charged particles and funneling them down to the Earth, down to the poles where the field's coming out. All right, so what happens as those charged particles get funneled down to the Earth's north and south pole, those charged particles, once they've reached the Earth's atmosphere, are going to hit the gases that are in our atmosphere. And that's going to cause those gases to get excited. And when a gas gets excited, it glows. Think of like a neon light that shines because there's gas in those tubes that is excited by the electricity running through it, and it causes the gas to glow. And it turns out that gases of different elements glow with different colors. And so the red color and the green color that we see are actually caused by oxygen. So higher up in the atmosphere, when that charged particle hits an oxygen atom that's really high up in the atmosphere, it causes it to glow red. The oxygen that sits a little bit lower in the atmosphere also glows green, and the green is brighter than the red, so it kind of outshines it. And so you see predominantly green. And then even lower than that, we have nitrogen, which glows blue. And so it looks kind of like this. And you can see that red from the oxygen high up, the green from the oxygen down below, and you can't really see the blue that sits below the green because it's really faint and hard to see at times. But this is where this glow of colors comes from, these charged particles from the sun that get trapped by our magnetic field, funneled down to the poles where they hit the atmosphere, hit the gas, excite it, and cause it to glow these different colors. This is also why the aurora sits kind of higher up in the atmosphere, because we're seeing where this interaction is happening. And it looks really, really cool when you can view it from space, like we're seeing here from the International Space Station. Now, those auroral zones that we saw earlier, the reason they can change and get kind of bigger or smaller depends on kind of how strong the solar wind is at any time, because just like any wind we experience here on Earth, it kind of changes strength. Or if we were to have a flare that heads our way, that could make a lot more stuff get through and hit our atmosphere, causing bigger, brighter, stronger auroras. But that's the kind of basics of what causes it. Charged particles from the sun hit our atmosphere and cause it to glow. And that's where our auroras come from. And you may not know this, but Earth is actually not the only planet to have auroras. In fact, almost all of the other planets in our solar system do show an aurora of some kind. And so what we're seeing here right now are Jupiter and Saturn. And they should look very similar, and very similar to Earth. The auroras that we see on these two planets look very nearly identical to the aurora that we see here on Earth. They're kind of these zones around the North and South Pole. Those zones kind of change and grow and shrink depending on the strength of the solar wind. They're created the same way. These planets are surrounded by a big magnetic field. But one of the differences here is the auroras on these planets are much, much, much brighter and stronger than the ones we have here on Earth. And that's because their magnetic field is a lot bigger and stronger. So it creates an even more dramatic aurora. In fact, the kind of blue color you're seeing here isn't the true color for these auroras. because the aurora actually predominantly shine in the ultraviolets. So we wouldn't really be able to see them with our naked eye. But that's, it's the same thing. It's just, you know, a bigger, stronger effect. Now, Uranus and Neptune. I couldn't find a good picture of Neptune's auroras, but here's Uranus. Looks quite different. It's just a kind of bright spot around the north and south magnetic pole of Uranus. Neptune's looks fairly similar, and while it's caused by somewhat of a similar process, there's enough strange things going on that it doesn't look the same. And to be perfectly honest, we don't understand it very well. Unfortunately, Uranus and Neptune are difficult for us to study from here on Earth because they're just so far away. And we've only had one spacecraft fly past. And that was the Voyager spacecraft back in the late 1980s. And so we just don't have as much information on these two planets. And so one of the many mysteries we still have yet to figure out are why Uranus and Neptune's auroras look so very different, even though we think they're caused by the same sort of process. Now, Venus and Mars also have auroras. Theirs do not look the same. They're not caused by the same thing, but they do have their own aurora type feature. Okay. So, as I know most people do, I'm sure many of you would like to see this for yourself if you haven't done so already. And so with this kind of last bit that we're going to talk to you about, I want to give you kind of some resources to help you plan when and where you could see the aurora, and give you some resources to kind of help track the forecast for the aurora, because we can kind of get an idea of how strong it's going to be. So in the description for this video, I've linked a couple of different sites, the spaceweather.com and the site for the NOAA. On both of these, oh, sorry, you may hear my kitten Quinn saying hi, but on both of these websites, they provide predictions for kind of where the aurora is going to be seen and how strong it's going to be. And so on both of these sites, you'll see a picture kind of like this, where it shows that auroral zone glow. And so it shows you kind of how far down on the United States, or how far down on North America it's coming. And of course, we want it to be down where we are in order to be able to see it. But the other thing that you're going to see is this KP index. And that's important because the KP index is kind of like the prediction of how strong and bright it's going to be. And so what we generally want is a KP index for your location to be at least 4 or 5. And then you have a chance at least of seeing it. The higher the KP index is, the stronger and brighter the aurora will be in your area, and the easier it's going to be to see. And so that's really what you want to look out for. You want this zone to be down where you are and the KP index to be at least a 4 or 5 or higher. And those two sites that I have linked, the spaceweather.com and the NOAA, give you that information so that you can see what could happen at your location. Now, very similar to both of these is a phone app that also does this. I've linked to where you could get it for both Androids and Apple. And it does the same thing, but it uses your GPS to know your specific location. And so it can give you your KP index and your aurora forecast for where you are based off of your GPS. And you can even set it up to send you alerts when that KP index starts to go up. And I've had this happen in the middle of the night. I get an alert that says, KP index is rising. If you want a chance of seeing the aurora, you should get outside in the next 20 minutes. And so that's a kind of easier way, and also a way to kind of have some notifications set up for you if you really want to try and see this. All right. Now, some good locations to go. Unfortunately, I can only give recommendations for Minnesota. If you are any further south, you are not really going to be able to see this. You need to be kind of in the northern U.S. To have a chance of seeing the aurora, unfortunately, just because the zones don't really dip that far down in the United States, unless we're having a really big event from the sun, like a coronal mass ejection, like a CME. But for those in Minnesota or surrounding areas, here are a couple of locations. So around Duluth in Brighton Beach is a relatively dark spot that you could have a chance of seeing the aurora. And I know one of my students has done so, actually has some really cool pictures that she has taken of the aurora from Brighton Beach. We have those in display outside of the planetarium whenever we can open back up, and then you can go see those. Now, the further north you go in Minnesota, the easier it's going to be able to see. So places up in Cook County around Grand Marais, Voyageurs National Park, that sort of thing, the northwest angle. But I have been told that it is possible to see the aurora down near the Twin Cities. So if you can get out of the city just a little bit to where it's a little bit darker on a stronger kind of aurora night, you could see it even as far south as the cities. Now, one thing to keep in mind, and it's a really common misconception, people have this idea that you can only see the aurora during the winter. And a lot of that is because the pictures that we see of auroras tend to always have snow on the ground. And that's because they're best seen further north, where there tends to be snow on the ground for a long portion of the year. But the truth is, you can see them all year. Any time of the year, it is possible to see an aurora, depending on, again, if the conditions are bringing the aurora down to where you are. But it doesn't have to be just in the winter. It could be any time of year. Now, a couple of things to keep in mind when you do go out to search for the aurora is it's probably not, in fact, most definitely not, going to look like it looks in pictures. For kind of mid to southern Minnesota, the aurora is actually going to be very, very low on the horizon. It's not going to be directly overhead. The further north you get, the more directly overhead it'll become. But it also may not seem as vibrant or colorful as we see in pictures. And that's just due to kind of the difference between cameras and our eyes. Cameras can be much more sensitive to the different colors. You can also leave them open to capture the light for a longer period of time than your eyes do. And so the actual aurora that you see may not be as colorful as it appears on camera. In fact, if it's a really, really dim aurora, you may have trouble discerning between whether it's actually the aurora or maybe some like really low gray cloud passing overhead. And this is where people tend to get disappointed because it doesn't look like the pictures. But quite honestly, I think it's still going to be amazing to see. I unfortunately haven't seen one yet, but I'm looking forward to the day that I do get to. So yeah, that is all about the aurora. Let me switch back over to us. Oops, there we go. So yeah, a little bit about what causes it, where you can see it, some good resources to help you find kind of forecasts and things. And like I said, I have links to all of this stuff in the description for the video. So I'm going to check in with Eli. Do we have any questions or anything you want to add?
No questions.
All right. Well, if you do have any questions, now is a great time to post them in the comments. And while we wait and see if we get any questions coming in, I want to talk to you guys about a few things we have going on. So you may have heard that we are doing a giveaway for a plush dino, just like the one that was taken up to the ISS by the Crew Dragon. And so on your screen now, you can see the website with all of the information. I've also got the website linked in the video description. And so what we want you to do is design a mission patch, which is really just a cool, colorful badge that has a picture and maybe the name of the mission. You can make one up for yourself or use one that happens. But we want you to make one and then submit it to us, either posting on social media or sending us an email, and you will be entered into the drawing for one of two of these dino plushies that we have. It's going to be a random drawing that we'll have on Wednesday, July 1st. So we're very excited about this. And then the other thing we have going on that was just announced earlier today is we are working on a couple of summer camps, a couple of virtual summer camps that we are going to have in July. And so we have two that we're going to be doing, one that's recommended for 6 to 8 year olds. That's our adventure through the solar system. And then we'll also have Exploring Alien Worlds virtual summer camp, which is recommended for 9 to 12 year olds. With these camps, you will get a box of supplies, and the camps will combine both kind of guided work that you'll do with Planetarium staff online, and then also just fun activities to do at home. So we're going to have more information about those coming out very soon, including cost, the exact dates, what you need to do to register, all of that. So we'll have that information out soon. We're very excited for these summer camps. All right. Anything come in?
Nothing more.
All right. Well, with that, I guess we will wrap things up. Next week, we have a couple of more great shows coming up. We've got on Wednesday a tour of the moons of the solar system. We've been to the planets a few times, but now we want to go look at some of the moons because they're really cool. And then next Saturday, we're going to take you on a tour of the Messier objects. These are things like galaxies, nebulas, star clusters, and we're going to tell you a little bit about them and some of them that will be easy for you to try and see this summer, because you can see them. Some of them you can see with your naked eye. Most of them you need at least a small telescope or a pair of binoculars, but we'll tell you all about it next weekend. So with that, I guess we will call it a night. Thank you to everyone for joining us. As usual, you can find any past shows on our YouTube channel or in the video section of our Facebook page. Thanks for joining us. We hope you have a wonderful rest of your summer solstice weekend. Check out the annular eclipse that's happening tonight, actually. We posted Bob King's article about it on our Facebook, which gives some live streams that you can go watch it for yourself, because we can't see it from here, but we can watch it online, which will be really cool. And yeah, have a great weekend, and we will see you guys later. So good night, everyone.